Live a day at a time is the clear command of the Lord. For us, just now, he knows that just this day is quite enough. Lord, help us to plan this hour as we can live this minute, leaving the rest to you. For next week, next month, next year, your rule of love and peace will surely come in ways we least expect. And those times are yours, and so are these, and so, Lord, are we. Would you please be seated? Well, good afternoon and welcome to this parish church as we meet today with tears and smiles to remember the precious life of Peter and to try to find some peace and comfort in the midst of all our grief and sadness. And our thoughts today are especially with Joanne and with Jeremy, with Tony and with Alison, and the grandchildren Beth and Esther, and Daniel and Nicholas, and with the wider family too, as they are joined together by so many friends in the midst of this church that he loved and so faithfully served for so many years. And a mark of how much Peter was loved is that despite his age and having been to the funerals of so many people, there are so many of you here today to pay tribute to him. And so we express and share our grief in our different ways, both grief at the loss of Peter and for the things that might have been and that should have been. And it's a day when we struggle to find answers to everything that's happened for the past several years. But we're also here to celebrate and remember his personality and his life and all that he meant to each person whose lives he did indeed so richly touch. And so we begin with a prayer for Peter and for all of us this day. Let us pray. Well, eternal God, we come to you because the one we knew and loved has died. We come before you today, each with our various needs. On this day of parting, do not abandon Peter, who we love. Do not desert us in our grief and our sadness, but give us strength and courage for this day, and some hope and some peace for tomorrow and all the days to come. And this we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Joanne has chosen a special poem, a special reading. It's the poem, God Saw You Getting Tired. Do you want to read it? Okay. Are you going to read it from there? Can I come and you stand there and I'll bring the microphone to you.
God saw you getting tired, and the cure was not to be. So he's put his arms around you and whispered, come with me. With tearful eyes, we watched you suffer and saw you fade away. Although we loved you dearly, we could not make you stay. A golden heart stopped beating, hard-working hands at rest. God broke our hearts to prove he only takes the best. You never said, I'm leaving. You never said goodbye. You were gone before we knew it, and only God knows why. In life, we loved you dearly. In death, we love you still. In our hearts, you hold a place that one could ever fill. It broke our hearts to lose you, but you didn't go alone, for part of us went with you the day God took you home.
You know, Peter spent so many happy years worshipping and serving God in this church, many of them as the verger. And small wonder that he left this list of precise instructions. And Jeremy will tell you it is precise. He's read it to me and I've seen it. But that was Peter, wasn't it? He wanted everything pristine. He would be really pleased to see that the grass has been cut and that the edges are knife sharp. Is that you, Jeff? Thought it might be. He always said you did lovely edges. The only thing that he'd let you do. He had a really favourite hymn, The Old Rugged Cross, and we're going to stand and sing that now for Peter.
Thank you.
you please be seated as Beth and Esther come and read some of their memories of Grandad.
We are proud to be here today as Peter's two loving granddaughters. We feel so privileged to have had Grandad as such a huge part of our lives for as long as we have. We have so many happy memories and we'd like to share just a few of them with you today. So many of our core memories from childhood feature Grandad. Pumpkin carving at Halloween, watching the fireworks on bonfire night, and Grandad being the first to fall asleep on Christmas afternoon, always still wearing his paper hat from the Christmas cracker. We had so many noteworthy trips with Nan and Grandad, whether it was our family favourite seaside day out to Dymchurch, or a family holiday we took to Salzburg, where Grandad loved trying the local beer and breakfast. He was a very dedicated Grandad. There was even one time I left some souvenirs I'd bought in a gift shop in Dymchurch, so he and Nan drove all the way back down there the following day just to pick up what I'd left behind. I can't think that there are too many people who would do something like that.
Grandad was always keen to teach us new things. In particular, we spent lots of time outside, whether in the garden or at his allotment. He loved to grow tomatoes, runner beans, new potatoes. In fact, when coming round from anaesthetic after surgery from repairing his broken arm, the first thing he said about was ordering grow bags for the greenhouse. Grandad enjoyed spending time with us and always laughed easily. On one occasion that particularly made him chuckle, when I was 2 years old and I asked him if our Auntie Yvonne had got her new knee for her knee replacement from the body shop.
Joking aside, Grandad could not have been a bigger supporter of everything that we did. He wanted to hear about every school report and every sports match. We could say he was perhaps a tad biased about the abilities of those he loved. He told us when he went to register our dad's birth, he told the lady at the registry office to remember his name because it is that of the country's future prime minister. And as for us, he was convinced I was one step away from being a CEO and that Esther is bound to end up as captain on one of the cruise ships she works on. Whilst these projections may have been slightly exaggerated, how lucky we are to have grandparents with so much faith in us.
Grandad amazed us at his ability to recall memories from so long ago, and we love listening to his stories of happy memories from the past. These included how he managed to build up the courage to ask Nan out on their first date all those years ago, despite his spiky blonde hair and missing two front teeth from a playground accident. He also recounted their cycling weekends to Southend, or him attempting to take ballroom dance classes with Nan, despite him having two left feet. We admired not only his incredibly detailed memory, but also his ability to adapt and progress with the times, including taking to modern technology. Despite growing up in an era where he had to use a tray of sand to learn how to write, he was excited to discover the wealth of information he could access on the internet. He first got a laptop at the age of 80, and he took computer classes every week to learn how to use it. He learned how to write emails so he could always keep in touch with us wherever in the world we were. He even added Facebook and YouTube to his repertoire, looking up the cruise ships that I was working on, photos of Beth's travels, or even new recipes to try.
Grandad definitely instilled the Shelton appreciation for food in both of us. I would say the number of meals we shared together is simply immeasurable. From roast dinners on a Thursday throughout our childhood, to pub lunches, fish and chips, we even got him to try Turkish and Chinese food as recently as last month. Speaking of recent times, as we got older, these meals would often include a glass of wine, sometimes shop-bought and sometimes his own homemade creation. If you were ever lucky enough to try his apple wine, you will know it didn't take more than a couple of sips to make you feel a little bit merry. In recent, more difficult times, the thought of sharing a gin and tonic with Est would always be something he would look forward to upon her return to dry lands, and we feel very lucky to have had this only a couple of weeks ago.
Whilst we'll never forget Grandad's love of York fruit sweets and bounties, there are so many more profound memories that we'll carry with us. We couldn't think of a better Grandad. Sorry, just take one second.
He has been a role model to us for as long as we can remember. He showed us honesty, integrity, respect for others, and to always put family first. His work ethic will be forever instilled in us, and we hope to possess the unwavering commitment and loyalty that he demonstrated. We know life wasn't always easy, but his resilience, perseverance, and strength of character is something that will inspire us for the rest of our lives. Although he would claim that these admirable qualities were just being a Shelton, to us, if that's what being a Shelton means, we're blooming proud to be one, and we hope to continue making him proud.
Jeremy's going to read a tribute to his dad and Joe's dad too.
I've got quite a lot to say because nearly 92 years is a long time, so bear with me. Dad never got to try lobster, but as we've heard, he did eat a Turkish meal and against all odds, asked to try Chinese at the age of 91 years and 10 months. I mention this because as a resolute meat and two veg man, he showed in later years a willingness to rethink his position on certain matters, and in this case, to reconsider his defence against eating what he called foreign muck. This wasn't the only way in which Dad mellowed. He became more prepared and better able to show his emotions, to express tolerance and, well, have a go at chicken chow mein. In his late 80s and with declining health, he set himself targets, no matter how small, to keep himself going, refusing to give in. And I'm convinced this extended his life. This included simple tasks, such as cooking a piece of salmon, maintaining aspirations to visit places and to try new foods. Sadly, he never got back down to Eastbourne or Dymchurch, and as I say, he never got to eat lobster. Dad was born on the 30th of April 1932, 2 years to the very day before Mum was to make her entry to the world. Sharing the same birthday was always a talking point throughout their united lives. Memorable dates were a speciality, it seems. Mum died on Boxing Day, Dad on Easter Monday. Dad's parents were Frederick Charles and Mary Ann Ada Shelton, or just Ada, and she was born a Fry. Dad had two brothers, David and Dennis. Sadly, David died in his 60s as a victim of cancer, and tragically, Dennis died as a young child following an illness and hospitalisation. Dad recalled his mother opening a telegram and standing sobbing at the kitchen sink, composing herself to say simply, "Dennis won't be coming home anymore." Despite this sadness, Dad's overriding childhood memories were happy ones. A real boy's boy, life was about scrumping, tree climbing, makeshift picnics, well, bread and jam and a bottle of water, up in the woods, and swimming in the Blue Lake. Despite his denials, his mum would always know he'd been to this dangerous and banned place from the chalky residue on his shoes and clothes. He was seven when war broke out, and often told us stories of what his life was like at the time. Walking to school featured an unofficial landmark and an associated rule. If the air raid siren sounded after this landmark, he and his brother would press on to school. If it was before, they would turn for home. So clearly you can imagine they dragged their heels as they walked up to the hill at Northfleet from Waterdales. Dad could recount many wartime stories. He knew where V1s, better known as doodle bugs, had landed, which houses in Collier Road and Vale Road had been destroyed by bombs, and poignantly told a story of a direct hit on an air raid shelter by an aerial torpedo, killing a young girl and her dog. He visited these sites with boyhood interest, and on one occasion saw a house, he told us, that was still intact but had been lifted from its foundations and moved so the front doorstep was now inside the house. It was during this time Dad worked on a horse-drawn vegetable delivery round. As well as helping the greengrocer distribute his wares and taking payment, he had a shared responsibility for the welfare of the horse. He didn't realise it at the time, but these experiences would lead to the naming of Dad's book of memoirs, which he wrote in his 80s. "Old the Horse's Head, Boy," was the title, taken from the greengrocer's instruction when they took shelter from an air raid under the arch in Waterdales and fearing that the horse would bolt. Dad did as he was told, but clearly would have been powerless to prevent the horse from taking off if it had decided to. More of Dad's book later. Dad's dad was a sapper, then a lance corporal in the Royal Engineers, Kent Fortress, Territorial Army, being too old for regular service. That said, he saw action. He and his comrades bravely went ashore multiple times in Holland and France in the face of the advancing Germans to help destroy fuel storage tanks to prevent the enemy from accessing vital oil supplies. This was a perilous task, often with no planned means of escape, and these courageous soldiers begged, borrowed and stole transport, limping back to Milton Barracks in dribs and drabs. Dad vividly remembered these absences and the concern that went with them. When his dad was home, he also recalled how he left his rifle leaning against the fireplace with six live rounds on the mantelpiece above the open fire. That's health and safety in action. Joanne reflects that Dad's phenomenal memory for such detail. She recalls how he would love to regale us children with stories from his childhood and his life in general, which many of you will have read in the memoirs. He'd started to write further about his national service until he became too poorly to continue, but we're sure that would have been a good read too. As a very young child, he remembered witnessing what he thought was the last horse-drawn funeral in Northfleet. And he remembered watching the progress of a gas-powered lorry through the rails of the front gate. As the girl said, he remembered in school using sand trays where alphabet and writing skills were honed, using an index finger tracing through the sand instead of pencil and paper. He left school at 14 and started an apprenticeship as a chainsmith with E.A. and H. Sanford down at the Canal Basin. I can only imagine what a tough profession that would have been in a harsh environment involving furnaces, molten steel, sledgehammers, and with little or no health and safety in place. A steel splinter in the eye, from which he once suffered, was resolved by old Fred, the first aider, with a children's paintbrush and a dob of saliva. When he was 18 and rather shy, Dad met 16-year-old Avril, our mum, in Southfleet Village. He asked her out, and to his amazement, she said yes. That was the first hurdle. Calling for her on the day in question at church houses, right next to the church path, he was greeted at the door by a very stern mother-in-law-to-be, not at that point that he was thinking that far ahead, and was told, "She's only 16, you know." Dad replied that he did know and that he would look after her. How prophetic those words turned out to be. Mum and Dad's teenage courting would have been unsophisticated but joyous. Cycling, again, as the girls have said, was an important leisure pursuit for them, riding all over Kent, and they think nothing of cycling to Southend for the day via Tilbury Ferry. They saw shows at Chatham Empire, including the great Frankie Howard, and if there was any money left after the bus fare, they'd have fish and chips on the way home. Dad was called up for national service, joining the Royal Engineers at railway workshops portside in Egypt. He worked as a boilersmith servicing steam trains. Mum and Dad married in September 53 in this very church. And soon after, Dad resumed his national service. A few years later, being called up due to Suez crisis, but fortunately he was stood down while stationed in Cyprus when the crisis resolved peacefully. In 1956, Joanne was born. I came along in 1960. Dad worked long hours in the most demanding of physical jobs, and Mum became the homemaker. In recent times, Dad voiced regret that he'd not been able to play a bigger part in our upbringing, but his work and the social norms of the day had held him back. I reassured him that we'd been happy children in a loving family and that he ought not feel bad about the past. As a family, we were never rich, but never in debt, always well fed and dressed, and even managed some modest family holidays, the most famous being to Cornwall, with Al, Paul, Maureen, Steve, Barb and John, and assorted kids. But that's another whole story in itself. Joan remembers Dad's love of motorbikes and how we used to go as a family to watch scrambling at Canada Heights in Swanley. I loved it, Joanne less so, but it was a whole family day out, so she had no choice. Joanne also recalls every Friday evening, Dad would return home via Marjoram's, the now defunct sweet shop in Gravesend, who buy us each a quarter of chocolate people, as we called them, a series of characters such as cowboys and Indians moulded from homemade chocolate. We were not allowed to eat them until after tea and would enjoy them whilst watching The Avengers on television. Dad and Mum enjoyed dancing and regularly joined Alan, Paul, Maureen and Stephen and others at local dances. At one stage, Mum and Dad even took ballroom dancing lessons at Gravesend's Leslie and Mania Studios. And they were pretty good, apart from the two left feet. They had a decent social life, and as kids, we loved spending time with Uncle Alan and Auntie Paul, Ali and Lou, the Holmans, Maureen and Steve, Andrew and Kevin, Smith, Barb, John, Steve, Julie and Roger Weeks always seemed ever-present too. Another of Joanne's recollections concerned the famous heatwave of 1976. We found ourselves in a nationally declared water shortage. Hose pipes were banned and consumption controlled generally. At the time, the garden was given over to vegetables and Dad was determined to find a means of watering his veg. Joanne remembers the whole family used the same bath water. Apparently, me first, then her, then Mum, and finally Dad. After this, Dad plunged a hose into the bath, passed the hose out the bathroom window, and somehow managed to siphon the entire contents with which to nourish the crops. Perhaps not the purest of water, we had a great crop of runner beans and potatoes that year. Maybe the soap helped. Mum was a terrific home cook and served up great steaming plates of delicious food, from roasts and casseroles and pies, and simply the best desserts and cakes. Dad loved this, as we all did, and in addition to eating well, he also learned from Mum how to cook. This could stood him in good stead if Mum was ever away, and later on when she was unable to inhabit the kitchen. He kept the roasts coming, made soup, made jam, he pickled his own onions, and made sure sausage rolls and cheese straws remained a Christmas or birthday party staple. Another fond memory of mine was watching sitcoms and comedy programs with Dad. Morecambe and Wise were a favorite, The Two Ronnies, Dad's Army, and any Carry On film. I was taken as a child to see Carry On Up the Khyber and Carry On Cowboy at Gravesend Cinema. I'll always remember Dad's response when something particularly tickled him. He went bright red, barely seemed able to catch his breath, and bent double, convulsed with laughter. Dad was delighted to become a grandparent and got to enjoy quality time with each of his grandchildren growing up. First Daniel and Nick, and then later Beth and Esther. Nick remembers Dad teaching him to play golf from the age of four, when the golf club was bigger than he was. He recalls Dad buying fireworks and enjoying setting them off, and that he even constructed a special frame for the Catherine wheels. Nick also remembers joining Dad to take Martha, our black Labrador, for a walk across the marshes, collecting blackberries. Dad used to relate the story of one particular day when walking along by the Blue Lake, it started raining, and Nick asked him if he'd go back and collect the car. Nick says Dad always called round to see them on a Friday evening when Mum went to choir practice, and regularly went to football matches on Sundays when Nick played for Northfleet Eagles. Dad also watched Daniel play soccer and later rugby too. Beth and Esther spent a good deal of time with Mum and Dad from an early age. They shared experiences in the garden and greenhouse, in the kitchen, at church events and on numerous days out. Dad used to chuckle about Beth's response when they dug potatoes on his allotment. "I don't want to eat dirty potatoes," she said. And he was moved to tears by Esther's theatrical debut as the Angel Gabriel, aged three. Dad loved his work in the lifting gear industry. Once he was no longer on the tools, he became more of a manager, running sales from the office and on the road, touring the UK. He referred to himself as a salesman, but I always told him that this sold him short. He really was more of a technical advisor to companies with complex needs to lift, pull, or otherwise move plant materials and other loads. He was highly sought after and well respected, handling inquiries long after his retirement because some firms would only deal with Pete. Dad was involved with St Nicholas Church for some 40 years, following Mum's traditional attachment here and that of her family. He was on the PCC. He worked for many years as a verger, as Marion said, helping to officiate at weddings, funerals, and at the interment of ashes. He was knowledgeable about the church and the grounds, the various procedures and regulations, and knowing where everything was kept. He was also forthright in his views, that may not surprise you, which he expressed in what I described as an unambiguous communication style. He was horrified at weddings to see lovely young brides with tattoos up their back and arms, and disgusted when a wedding party departed, having left what he regarded as a miserly contribution to the collection plate. He was one of the originals who formed the Mowers Group and was proud of the team's contribution to keeping the churchyard tidy and well tended. As well as cutting the grass, he came up with the idea of planting hundreds of daffodil bulbs and planted snowdrops to add to the beauty of the church grounds, having persuaded local businesses to part with the bulbs for free. As a founding member of the Mowers, it seemed inevitable, and perhaps his right, that he'd be the first casualty of petrol-driven grounds equipment when he walked backwards, pulling a powerful machine, stumbling, and managed to sever the best part of his big toe. Of late, he'd been irritated to hear the mowers referred to as gardeners. That made him angry. And he was also angry that the churchyard had been earmarked to host spooky Halloween stories, which he thought disrespectful. As I've said, Dad always clearly made his feelings known, and these two instances were no exceptions. Dad also clashed with the village retirement group, challenging how it was run and how the chair refused to give others a voice. So he launched a breakaway club, Surge, or the Southfleet Independent Retirement Group. I always thought that'd be a great sitcom, Battle of the Retirement Groups. This proved popular endeavour, and Dad ran numerous events, coach trips to the seaside, Thursford, and even France, where wine was bulk purchased for future events at the village hall. As I've said, Dad remarkably wrote his memoirs when he was in his 80s, an achievement of which he was rightly very proud. It took a while, as he found less and less time due to caring for Mum, but he got there in the end. I have a few copies with us today, which I'll take to the Little Hermitage if anyone would care to see them, or I can order more copies if anyone would like a copy. A lot of people had known Dad for a very long time, and you'll each have your own particular memories of him. Ali and Lou knew him all their lives, and have fond memories of many family get-togethers over the years. He's been ever present for Beth and Esther, Lottie and James too, all of whom loved his company, his storytelling, his sense of humour, and his amazing general knowledge. Alison and my best friend Andy knew and loved him for 40 years, and the love was mutual. Many church friends, such as Sue and Dermot O'Connor, knew him for over 40 years. Maureen, more family than friend, for 62 years, and Maureen will miss their entertaining chats. She and Ali joined Dad in what they called the Lunch Club, a monthly get-together at the ship with fish and chips at home when Dad was less able to get about. They'd also enjoy the odd bottle of Dad's wine from his wine club, something else he loved, although he flatly refused to buy any wines from the EU. We didn't see eye to eye over that. Barb and John also go way back, many years through dances and gatherings and through the church. Jean Rookledge, a valued friend to Dad and Mum over many years. Her love and support have been unwavering. And dear Jeff too, a real friend. Marion, our minister today, has known Dad all her life. And this started when Dad visited her home when she was born. Again, truly a friend for life. All those years ago, Dad said he'd look after Mum, and he was true to his word. He couldn't have done more for her through her declining health as she descended further into the grip of Alzheimer's. These were difficult years, but he never faltered, despite battling prostate cancer himself. He was relieved that it was not his decision when Mum was moved into residential care on safety grounds. After Mum died, Dad slowly began to deteriorate. In a way, his plight was the opposite of Mum's. Where she had lost her mental capacity, Dad's mind was sound, he remained sharp to the very end. And whilst this was great in most respects, it also meant he had to witness his own physical decline. And he found this really hard. But he did it with dignity. He managed to remain independent, had a positive outlook, and maintained his interests in the lives of his children and grandchildren, of whom he was intensely proud. He admired Beth for her school and university achievements, for spending time living and working in Germany, for her adventures in Madagascar, and as a volunteer for the London and Rio Olympic Games. He was in awe of Esty's song and dance achievements, for standing alone on stage in the spotlight, and her courage to venture around the world on cruise ships. He was delighted when she went to Alaska, somewhere he'd always wanted to visit. Mostly, though, he appreciated Beth's and Esther's continued visits all through their adult lives. They spent time with him regularly, and this always gave Dad a boost. This was priceless. He didn't always show it, but he was grateful for the things people did for him, whether it was Joanne doing his shopping, Tony popping in for a coffee and a chat and cutting the grass, or Ali organising the lunch club. And he appreciated Alison, often apparently stood in the background, but steering me and making things happen. She also took the unenviable task of regularly washing his feet, including his half-missing toe. Okay, last bit. I consider myself fortunate that I probably got to know Dad better and got closer to him over the past 25 years, more so than any other time in my life. Firstly, supporting him through Mum's decline and also with his own health challenges. During this time, he let his guard down and, as I said at the beginning, he mellowed. He never lost his forthright views, though. Latterly, those that fell outside his circle of family or friends, who rubbed him up the wrong way, fell victim of a simple classification system in which there were just two categories. Unfortunately, in asking me to say a few words at his funeral, he forbade me to swear, so I'm afraid I can't elaborate further, but maybe ask me later over a beer. His other instruction for today was that for his final journey, he wanted a small hammer in his right hand. And I quote, "just in case I need to let you know I'm still around." We granted him that wish, but we've heard no such alarm today. So, sorry, Dad, you've had your chance. In closing, I'd like to tell you that Dad's 1945 school report recorded his geography performance as disappointing. Yet he had the most amazing sense of direction and geographic knowledge of the UK's roads and towns. His moral compass was exemplary too, and I like to think he's led us and we followed him down the right road.
Just thank you for sharing so much, all of you. We're going to have a moment of silence to remember Pete with love. Have some prayers for Pete and for his family. But you know, the value and meaning of life does consist in living it well. And people who bring love and joy to others and enrich their lives are the people who create for us all a meaning and a value in life. And Peter through all his years was such a person, as we've heard today and as we've known forever. His influence will endure in the unending consequences that flow from that character of his, the things he did. The joy of having known and loved Peter will never disappear, but his memory will remain with us forever. And so we pray. Lord, today we give thanks for Peter, for his life, for his work, for his generous spirit, for his honesty and integrity, for all that was so good in his life, for his love for Avril. He always called her the prettiest girl in Southfleet. His love for the family, for his friendship, for the memories we hold today and every day. Lord, we give profound thanks. And we pray today that you will draw close to Joanne and Jeremy and Tony and Alison, to grandchildren Beth and Esther, and Daniel and Nicholas, to family, to friends, that you will bring them their comfort and your peace. And we remember especially today all those who we love who have died, those whose memories we have fleetingly shared in, Peter's parents Fred and Ada, his brothers David and Dennis, and members of the wider family and friends too. And we pray, Lord, that you will be with all who mourn this day, that they may know your presence and comfort and your deep peace. So, dear God, we thank you for all this love that we have known, for the joys and the sorrows shared with Peter. We accept that you've taken back this precious life that you once gave. May you bring your gentle healing and your peace to pain that comes from parting with him. Lead him home now to you so that he may rest where pain and distress are no more, and where you will wipe away all tears. And this we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we join together to say the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And so now you've turned the page in your order of service to see the amazing photographs, just a snapshot of Pete's life. Take this order of service home with you. Remember Pete, remember Avril, remember their life, their service, their love, their integrity. And think of the family in these days and weeks and months and years to come. Good parents raise good children. His mum and dad knew that. He knew that. And these two sitting here know that too. We're going to stand to sing our second hymn, How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
song of praise for God's wonderful creation in the midst of this beautiful village, surrounded by a perfect April day. It was a favourite hymn of both Peter and Avril, but we remember from that, when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. And Peter is at home. Alison is going to come and read Psalm 121 at the request of Peter for this day.
Psalm 121, as chosen by Peter, the Lord, our protector. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you. So we've been remembering with love and gratitude, with tears and smiles, the life of Peter. And I know that you will all support each other in the times to come, and that you will find enormous strength from that. Remember Peter. Talk about him often. He has such wonderful times in his life, and he wouldn't wish you to be sad all the time. He'd want you to cherish those happy memories of him, even his grumpy moments, to smile when you remember him. And bear in mind that the finest of all possible tributes is to hold the best of all that Peter stood for. He wasn't afraid to speak his mind or stand up for what he thought was right. To let that live on in your own lives and to focus on how much he has enriched your lives, with your family, with your friends, with your community. Just think how that will continue. So at the end of this service, we'll travel to Thamesview Crematorium for a short service of committal. And all are welcome, but those who prefer not to join us there are warmly invited to meet at the little hermitage, and the details are on your order of service. Now we're going to commend Peter to the love and care of God, our Maker and Redeemer. God, our Father, we thank you that you have made each of us in your own image and given us gifts and talents with which to serve you. We thank you for Peter, the years we shared with him, the love we saw in him, the care we received from him. Now give us the strength and the courage to leave him in your care, confident in your promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So God bless Peter. Rest in peace now. Amen.
Mostrar tutto il mio cuore che è acceso, chiuso.
sogno l'orizzonte manca le parole. Io sì lo so che sei con me, con me. Tu mia luna, tu sei qui con me. Mio sole, tu sei qui con me.